From the rising of the sun to its setting, my name is great among the nations. And in every place, my incense is offered in my name. And it's a pure offering, for my name is great among the nations, says the Lord.
Before we go, just say,
there should be a fire in your heart
and a race when you race
consuming every part because you know
the God
we serve will make his presence known when
Blessed be God, by whose grace we are yet alive. And blessed be his Son, Jesus Christ, by whose rising we are set free. And blessed be the Spirit of God, in whom is our hope and our joy.
The God we serve will make heaven known. You
Yeah.
your hand and you stand up and say that there is none. Oh, somebody needs to say it. When you praise, when they praise. It's all right if you want to clap your hands if you want to.
The Jubilate. Oh, shout to the Lord in triumph, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness and come before his face with songs of joy. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who has made us. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Come into his gates with thanksgiving. Come into his courts with praise. Give thanks unto him and bless his holy name. For the Lord is good. His loving mercy is forever. His faithfulness throughout all generations. Glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Lord, we pray to you for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone, and so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Set us free from the bondage of our sins, and give us the liberty of that abundant life which you have made known to us in your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Psalms 56 and 57. Have mercy on me, O God, for my enemies are hounding me. All day long they assault and oppress me. They hound me all the day long. Truly, there are many who fight against me, O Most High. Whenever I am afraid, I will put my trust in you. In God, whose word I praise, in God I trust and will not be afraid. For what can flesh do to me? All day long they damage my cause. Their only thought is to do me evil. They band together, they lie in wait, they spy upon my footsteps because they seek my life. Shall they escape despite their wickedness? O God, in your anger, cast down the peoples. You have noted my lamentation. Put my tears into your bottle. Are they not recorded in your book? Whenever I call upon you, my enemies will be put to flight. This I know, for God is on my side. In God, the Lord, whose word I praise, in God I trust and will not be afraid. For what can mortals do to me? I am bound by the vow I made to you, O God. I will present to you thank offerings, for you have rescued my soul from death and my feet from stumbling. that I may walk before God in the light of the living. Psalm 57. Be merciful to me, O God, be merciful, for I have taken refuge in you. In the shadow of your wings I will take refuge until this time of trouble has gone by. I will call upon the Most High God, the God who maintained my cause. He will send from heaven and save me. He will confound those who trample upon me. God will send forth his love and his faithfulness. I lie in the midst of lions that devour the people. Their teeth are spears and arrows, their tongue a sharp sword. They have laid a net for my feet, and I am bowed low. They have dug a pit before me, but have fallen into it themselves. Exalt yourself above the heavens, O God, and your glory over all the earth. My heart is firmly fixed, O God, my heart is fixed. I will sing and make melody. Wake up, my spirit, awake, lute and harp. I myself will awaken to dawn. I will confess you among the peoples, O Lord. I will sing praise to you among the nations. For your loving kindness is greater than the heavens, and your faithfulness reaches to the clouds. Exalt yourself above the heavens, O God, and your glory over all the earth. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and it shall be forever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Isaiah, chapter 51. Beginning at verse 17 through verse 23. Rouse yourself, rouse yourself. Stand up, O Jerusalem, you who have drunk at the hand of the Lord the cup of his wrath, who have drunk to the dregs the bowl of staggering. There is no one to guide her among all the children she has borne. There is no one to take her by the hand among all the children she has brought up. These two things have befallen you. Who will grieve you? Devastation and destruction, famine and sword. Who will comfort you? Your children have fainted. They lie at the head of every street, like an antelope in a net. They are full of the wrath of the Lord, the rebuke of your God. Therefore, hear this. You who are wounded, who are drunk, but not with wine. Thus says your sovereign, the Lord. Your God who pleads the cause of his people. See, I have taken from your hand the cup of staggering. You shall drink no more from the bowl of my wrath. And I will put it into the hand of your tormentors, who have said to you, bow down that we may walk on you. And you have made your back like the ground, and like the street for them to walk on. This is the word of the Lord.
Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel. He has come to his people and set them free. He has raised up for us a mighty Savior, born of the house of his servant David. Through his holy prophets he promised of old that he would save us from our enemies, from the hands of all who hate us. He promised to show mercy to our fathers and to remember his holy covenant. This was the oath he swore to our father Abraham, to set us free from the hands of our enemies, free to worship him without fear, holy and righteous in his sight all the days of our life. You, my child, shall be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his way, to give his people knowledge of salvation by the forgiveness of their sins. In the tender compassion of our God, the dawn from on high shall break upon us, to shine on those who dwell in darkness and in the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be. Amen.
A reading from the book of Mark, chapter 7, beginning at verse 24 through verse 37. From there he set out and went away to the region of Tyre. He entered a house and did not want anyone to know he was there. Yet he could not escape notice. But a woman whose little daughter had an unclean spirit immediately heard about him, and she came and bowed down at his feet. Now the woman was a Gentile of Syrophoenician origin. She begged him to cast out the demon out of her daughter. He said to her, "Let the children be fed first, for it is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." But she answered him, "Sir, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs." Then he said to her, "For saying that, you may go. The demon has left your daughter." So she went home, found the child lying on the bed, and the demon gone. Then he returned from the region of Tyre and went by way of Sidon towards the Sea of Galilee, in the region of the Decapolis. They brought to him a deaf man who had an impediment in his speech, and they begged him to lay his hand on him. He took him aside in private, away from the crowd, and put his fingers into his ears, and he spat and touched his tongue. Then, looking up to heaven, he sighed and said to him, "Ephphatha," that is, "be opened." And immediately his ears were opened, his tongue was released, and he spoke plainly. Then Jesus ordered them to tell no one. But the more he ordered them, the more zealously they proclaimed it. They were astounded beyond measure, saying, "He has done everything well. He even makes the deaf to hear and the mute to speak. Word of the Lord.
What have I to ask beside? Can I doubt his tender mercy, who through life has been my guide? Heavenly peace, divinest comfort, here by faith in him to dwell. For I know whatever befall me, Jesus doeth all things well. For I know whatever befall me, Jesus doeth all things well. All the way my Savior leads me, 'tis each winding path I tread, gives me grace for every trial, feeds me with the living bread. Though my weary steps may falter, and my soul athirst may be, gushing from the rock before me, a spring of joy I see, gushing from the rock before me, though a spring of joy I see. All the way my Savior me, oh, the fullness of his love, perfect rest to me is promised in my Father's house above. When my spirit, clothed immortal, wings its flight to realms of day, this my song through endless age, Jesus led me all the way. This my song through endless ages. Jesus led me all the
The Advocate. Isaiah chapter 51 verse 22 reads, "Thus says your sovereign, the Lord, your God, who pleads the cause of his people." God who pleads the cause of his people. Isaiah is here using an image, a legal image, to represent the relationship between God and his people. God is presented as an advocate of his people, or advocate for his people. God is compared to a lawyer who is representing his client. In order for us to truly understand the image here and to appreciate what this means to us in terms of the gospel message, we will need to take a closer look at the judicial system so that we can have a clearer insight. First of all, there are two sides to the justice system, the prosecution and the defense. Let's first start by looking at the prosecution. The prosecution represents the people. The people are cast as the victim of an abuse of law against them. Their standard of fairness and their standards of justice has been attacked and violated. And so the prosecution stands as an accuser to the accused of perpetrating this crime, the person accused of breaking the law. The prosecutor attempts to prove that this person, this accused, is the person who has perpetrated the crime. Thus, the prosecutor stands on behalf of the people against those who are breakers of the law. And this law is the law that everyone agreed to live by. Let's talk about the law. Our law predicates that we are all essentially law-abiding citizens, law-abiding people. We are essentially good at the core. We agree that the law is good, and we agree that these are our highest standards. Our law, the one in Trinidad and Tobago for sure, is based on our belief in God. It says that in the Constitution that our rights are God-given. And so by our own agreement that God exists and that our laws of justice are predicated upon the presence of God, then by so accepting the law, we are tacitly in agreement that we are people of God, essentially, and that the law becomes a manifestation of our social conscience. The scripture is saying in part that God is the prosecutor who stands on behalf of us all, and he stands for righteousness. He is saying that we as citizens of his universal sovereignty, we are people who have been created in his image and in his likeness, and therefore at the core of our being, we are essentially good. We are essentially loving. We are essentially kind. We are essentially law-abiding citizens. Now, because we are law-abiding citizens and because we are essentially good, then we are worthy of protection by this same law against those who are perpetrators, and we are worthy of justice meted out to those who are perpetrators against us. So immediately then we become victims of those who are perpetrating law, breaking the law. Now, immediately a problem emerges. The problem is this. While we are all subjects of the law and essentially good people, we are the very ones, every single one of us, who are also breakers of that law. We are also perpetrators, and we are due for justice by the very prosecutor who is looking to defend our rights. So ironically, we are both victims in need of justice and at the same time perpetrators in need of judgment. Thankfully, there's another section of the law. And that section is called the defense. The defense also represents the people, but in this case, the people accused. Everyone is entitled to a defense, guilty or not. If this person does not have a representative, an advocate, then the people, the state, provides them with one. So the defender is given to the perpetrator, or at least to the accused, to be able to have a proper defense. And so the defense stands ready to defend the innocence of their client. And since everyone is essentially good and law-abiding, and everyone is therefore given the presumption of innocence until proven guilty. This means that even if the accused is indeed and in fact the perpetrator, they still have to be found guilty in court to be able to be liable for punishment. And so we are all indeed in fact sinners. We establish that. We constantly break the law that we all agree is fair. From the court to the banks to all our systems are in a mess. And yet, God in Christ is standing as advocate to prove in God's court and before the community of our social consciences that we are not guilty and that we are not liable for punishment. Now, how in the world will Jesus accomplish that? Because you and I know that indeed we are guilty. But the Bible says that Jesus has a strategy. Our advocate's strategy, our lawyer, is to present the court the real guilty party, and in so doing, prove our innocence. He planned to say that he was the guilty one, and in so doing, set us free. And that is what he did. When he took our punishment on the cross, he took it because he said, "I am guilty. Set them free." Now the question is, does this mean that by taking the blame for something he didn't do, that Jesus Christ lied to the court of God and lied to the jury, our conscience? No, he did not. I put it to you, he did not. He simply agreed with the court that people are essentially good, that people are essentially law-abiding, and that everyone is, by presumption, innocent. And by becoming himself human, and by living as one and the only one who is pure, holy, and guiltless of anything, the only one who is law-abiding, the only one who's pure, the only one who was loving without fault, he proved that humanity is good. So the exception proved the rule. And so in his innocence, he took humanity's punishment of sin for death. As one of the people, he identified with our sin. He identified with our rebellion. And so he took our punishment. In exchange, Christ credited us with his righteousness. Having fulfilled the judgment for sin through his death, and I mean sin past, present, and future, all sin, once and for all, Jesus Christ now stands before the Father as our advocate, having completed the work, and we stand before the Father as pure and innocent because someone has already taken the blame. Now, because he was innocent, it was unfair for the Father to leave him in the grave. And so God, the Father, raised him from the dead. And now he stands before the Father as proof of our continued innocence as we are seen and viewed by God as in him. But what about those who are continuously lawless, who reject this sacrifice? What becomes of us who consistently and persistently act lawless? What does God do? Well, They are those who reject Christ's salvation, and they are choosing to take personal responsibility for their sin, even though they were deemed by the court, the heavenly court, as innocent. They are going to allow their consciences to tell them a lie, and they're going to continue in sin because that's the life they prefer. And because God has given us free will, then he must allow those of us who flout the law and who reject his salvation to make the choice for hell. Sadly, they die saved. So, what does God do about those of us who accept his salvation and who rejoice in his death and his resurrection and his continual advocacy? For those of us, Jesus Christ has set us free from sin, and he's willing to keep us free because he continually pleads our innocence and prepares us as we grow in holiness. He continually attributes to us his righteousness, and he continually helps us to become better and better people through his Holy Spirit. He sent his Holy Spirit to help us to grow into the kind of people that we really are. You remember, we're essentially good, and we hit a bad spot. And so Christ is now giving us the ability to be and to live as the kind of people that we truly are. How does that make us feel today? That we have an opportunity for salvation, and that we have an advocate before the Father who pleads our case. I know that makes me very happy. It makes me very grateful, and it makes me very conscious of the life I live in the face of his sacrifice. What about you? Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for sending your divine Son, Jesus Christ, as our sacrifice for our sin. I thank you personally for sending him for my sin. Thank you for raising him up and for continually recognizing his advocacy on my behalf. I personally thank you. I thank you, Jesus Christ, for dying in our place and for pleading our case and for sending the Holy Spirit to keep us holy. I thank you personally. I thank you, God, for Jesus Christ, for your sacrifice. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit of God, for your continued presence, for your prompting, for your power. Oh God, we thank you, I thank you, for uniting us to share in your unity. In the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns. Amen.
Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
The Suffrages. Suffrage C. Save your people, Lord, and bless your inheritance. Govern and uphold them now and always. Day by day we bless you. We praise your name forever. Lord, keep us from all sin today. Have mercy on us, Lord. Have mercy. Show us your love and mercy, for we put our trust in you. In you, Lord, is our hope, and we shall never hope in vain. The Collect. Almighty and everlasting God, you govern all things both in heaven and on earth. Mercifully hear the supplications of your people, and in our time grant us your peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the rest of the past night and for the gift of a new day, with its opportunities of pleasing you. Grant that we may so pass its hours in the perfect freedom of your service, that at evening we may again give you thanks through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Prayer of Dedication. Almighty God, we thank you for the gift of your holy word. May it be a lantern to our feet, a light to our paths, and a strength to our lives. Take us and use us to love and serve all persons in the power of the Holy Spirit and in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us evermore. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let's bless the Lord. Thanks be to God.